welcome to the Additive Manufacturing Podcast. I'm Kevin Keefe. I'm the marketing manager at CAD Dimensions, and I'm here with Adam Fosnut. He is our 3D printing application specialist, and Fred Compton. He is one of our SOLIDWORKS engineering specialists, and we're actually in a new venue today. We are in our state-of-the-art Fab Lab. This is an extension of our Fab Lab, actually, where we normally do this podcast, but today we are in the studio where we have our desktop metal studio. So this is the studio where there's a studio.
Yes, in a way.
Because it's a studio in the sense that we're shooting this, and it's a studio in the sense that that's the name of the machine.
Yes, that's right.
This is brand new, though. Adam, tell us about what's behind everybody here.
Sure. So we have the desktop metal studio system. Behind Kevin, we have the printer itself.
Oh,
that could have been terrible. And we have the debinder. So it's a 3-step process to get metal parts. You print the parts. We would call them green parts. We debind them. Dissolves away most of the plastic binding agents, and then you throw them in the furnace, and then you have metal parts. Didn't we shoot our first podcast back here?
Did we shoot the first one back here?
The second podcast?
First or second.
Okay. We've been back here before, though. Yeah, we just didn't have the furnace.
Maybe I wasn't
But
here.
Now we have the furnace, so we've got the full setup.
Yes, that's right. Here.
But we have the full setup now. We've been printing, debinding, and actually sintering parts really since we got it. So it's been fun.
Does it get warm in this room?
Machine.
With the furnace in here?
Yeah, Ken is nodding at me off camera that it does. His office is on the other side of the half wall. So it gets a little warm. What's nice though is that I've touched the surface of the furnace like when it's in the middle of a sintering cycle, and it doesn't burn you or it doesn't feel hot to the touch on the outside.
Let's see both your hands.
Still not burned. No, we were doing a demo for a customer earlier, and I mentioned that like your coffee is hotter than the outside of the furnace when it's 1400 Celsius.
Wow.
Sintering metal on the inside, so it's pretty cool.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it's well insulated.
Yeah, I guess so. I wonder what. That's not just like, you know, Pink Panther on the inside.
Though. No, not quite. you need something a little sturdier than that. It's some well engineered. High-grade ceramics on the inside of there.
That's pretty neat. And now this is really just the first of two machines that Desktop Metal is going to have out. The production machine is still not available yet, but that's going to be on a bigger scale. I remember seeing, I believe they had some demo units of this last year at SolidWorks World. We're gearing up here in the office to head to SolidWorks World in Dallas later next week. And I know that Desktop Metal has a spot in the partner pavilion there. I'm sure Stratasys does as well. So
yep.
I remember they had... I believe they announced the Replicator there 2 years ago or last year. That was at Rapid. I'm sorry. That was at Rapid in Pittsburgh where they brought the Replicator out for the first time.
You're thinking of a different Replicator that I mentioned before we started recording.
Oh, well, see, that's what we get for having idle chatter before the podcast, actually. We use all the good material.
They announced what we call the Continuous Build Demonstrator at Rapid in
Demonstrator.
Pittsburgh.
Okay, Demonstrator Replicator.
In 2017. Yeah. You know, they're very similar names.
I'll
let you have this one.
So then what's the difference between the Demonstrator and the Replicator?
The Replicator was the name that MakerBot named their product line with quite a bit. We have the Continuous Build Demonstrator, and then the Replicator I mentioned previously was a 3D printing story right at the end of January, which is actually a new method of 3D printing that's been researched that 3D prints objects pretty much immediately. So it's based on, I think it's MRI technology, where it's essentially a new way of curing resin. So it's really similar to an SLA or a DLP 3D printer, but it uses a cylinder of resin. Think of like a beaker in chemistry, and then it has a video projector on the side, and they spin it really quickly, and they project the image not on the surface, but like in the center of the cylinder. And so in like 45 seconds of this thing spinning and the projector going, you see like objects just appear and then they kind of like flow to the surface slowly.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it's a really cool process.
So this is like
process.
New technology or this is like...
Yeah, this was a research project. I forget the university that this research is happening at, but it's rare that I see, you know, companies are always saying, this is brand new, this is ours, and they love making up acronyms for it. a pet peeve of mine. Okay. But it's rare that I see a truly new method of 3D printing, which this is.
That's really cool because it's not niche, right? Right. In previous podcasts, we've talked about how a lot of the future of 3D printing is going to be coming up with niche machines that do just ceramic or just silicon or just, you know, one specific material or something like that. And it's going to focus on more of those micro targets. And this is kind of a little bit different than that.
Yes.
In that this is really totally different new technology and entirely.
Yes. And because it's still in the research stage, I wouldn't expect it to be commercialized really anytime soon.
Sure.
It'll take time to develop it out. You know, the first prints that they showed in their pictures don't look nearly as great as what SLAs or PolyJets can do today.
Mm-hmm.
But the point is, it's a proven method at the research level to make a 3D object. And so as technology progresses, we can only expect it to get better and better from there.
See, I like when Adam nerds out about stuff. You get excited about stuff like this. It's cool because, I mean, in this conversation, we've kind of had a few different things. We've talked about, in the past, 3D different 3D printing technology like this and news and stuff like that. And we've tried some different topics. And I have to bring us around to some current events, at least, because there's a lot of cool things going on in 3D printing. You know, everybody was watching the football game, apparently, that was last week.
Was there a football game last week?
I forget what happened.
It was barely a football game.
We're in upstate New York, so, you know, you have to recognize that we're going to be homers here for everybody but Tom Brady. So to see that happen was very, very sad. But 3D printing is actually catching a lot of headlines because they're finding a lot of applications for Riddell. I know, is doing a big undertaking trying to see how they could use 3D printing applications to make helmets safer and apply that technology to more padding. And I can only imagine that, you know, the variety of materials lends itself to a lot of experimentation, allows them to look at, you know, different absorption factors, or God only knows. What do you think about that kind of application?
Sure. So I think what carbon did all surrounding this 3D printed football helmet story is really interesting from a few different angles, especially marketing angles, so you can appreciate it. So Carbon released all the work they've been doing, I think, throughout 2018 around 3D printed football helmets. And so what they do is they scan a player's head, and then they use really intelligent software that they've previously applied to making insoles for Adidas shoes. And they've applied that to generating 3D models to be able to be, you know, strong in some areas and softer in other areas, and then 3D print urethane lattices on their machines. So instead of using foam padding, we're using custom-made 3D printed plastic.
I feel like I've seen tires that look like that, right?
Yeah, I'm sure you have.
Yeah, I feel like on like Jeep ads or something like that, there is a tire and the filling, like the interior of the tire is just like that hard plastic lattice work, right?
Yeah.
So the helmet's kind of structured in a similar way, and that's better for the person. And it's customized too. It's specific to their head.
Yeah. I was looking at the story earlier, and I think they have over 50 helmets in the NFL today. And so like one player on every single team has one of these helmets, which I had no idea it would have been that widespread. Lots of times people will put out press releases like this and just talk about what they did, but it's really like, oh, they played a scrimmage with the helmet and no one died. But this is like people are actually using it today as an end-use part, which is pretty cool. On top of that, they announced a new machine. And so this is a larger format
carbon
3D printer. Yes. And so it was the time of the Super Bowl. They had a great case study, and on top of that, they launched a new, larger format machine. And so, from a marketing perspective, they did a fantastic job with it. But it's a cool application. I think it's cool seeing them broaden from just shoes to applying their software and their materials to, you know, other products. People don't talk about their software as much, but really that's what makes this application possible in a lot of ways.
Is it like the intricacies with the lattice work, or is that specifically that?
Yes. And so we were talking earlier, Fred made a lattice for something that we might have wanted to print on desktop metal. But generating a lattice you can do in a lot of different ways. And so they have one of the few softwares that will analyze the shape, in this case, of someone's head, the forces that will be putting on the padding, and then automatically create a lattice of varying strengths.
Okay. So when you were designing that lattice work today, Fred, how did you go about determining what was going to be the way that you wanted it structured so that it was going to be, because I think it was like the shaft of a hammer, I think is what we were trying to envision here. So how did you go about designing that?
I just kind of like compared it to more, if you think about in the engineering world, a lot of things are borrowed from other stuff. Mm-hmm. So the main thing that I really borrowed that from was basically like crane design. Cranes have that lattice structure on them, like a, you get that big, you know, crane you see over a city, right?
Sure.
Like a construction crane. And they all have that typical lattice pattern of everything is triangles. And typically you want to keep that triangular shape. And that's honestly all I really did. And
triangle's the strongest shape, right?
Yeah.
I feel like my kid told me that and I was a little hesitant to believe it. I'm like, that makes sense. Like, I'm an adult, but I guess I didn't know that. So
yeah, I mean, it's a square. You can just kind of like fold them.
Crumple it. And then, yeah, squares. The more like I thought about it, I'm like, damn, you smart.
Yeah, there you go. So I kind of like put that inside of the hammer in the line that would allow for some flex.
Right.
So because in general with lattice allows a little bit of flexing, but not a lot. And so it's just a way of distributing stress across the entire thing, really.
And that was really why we thought that would fit perfectly for the shaft of a hammer, because you're trying to absorb the shock and let that dissipate through the arm of it. And it was neat because then you were able to see in SOLIDWORKS, you were able to simulate and validate that it was, you know, where were going to be the stress points and things like that. How would that energy get distributed? And you could even easily point out if there was an issue somewhere, something was wrong in the part file.
Yeah, when it says it's got more force than, you know, a nuclear bomb going off or something where it's going to be breaking, right. And you know something's going to break when it comes to that. But it came out okay. There were some points that we got to like figure out and fix, but obviously we won't be able to do too much with it right now.
Sure.
But it's
a future project. Maybe that's another video we do down the road. I think there are some people here who are hellbent on making some really cool stuff with this with the metal 3D printer behind us. So
yeah. Oh yeah.
We'll get creative as we go along for sure. So I originally found this article that Ben had sent along. I found an article that Ben had sent. I read the article. On a company made 3D printing a component that it went into a wireless charging thing. And I think about this a lot more frequently. Do you guys have phones that charge wirelessly with the little thing in the back? You just drop it on
I do not.
No, so I'm the only one?
My phone is also too old.
I was going to say, your phone, does it flip from the side? Is it the candy bar phone?
If I could still be using one of those and function in this world,
you'd go back to a Motorola Razr tomorrow.
I might. I hung on to
my LG V2.
I've held on to my phone that had a physical keyboard way longer than I should have. Everyone else had. I was so afraid to have a touchscreen that was my keyboard.
Yeah.
I was really wary about that.
I was the same way. I got the BlackBerry that clicked because I needed that tactile sensation of I did press the button and it was horrible.
Yeah.
I had it about a week.
I was being ridiculous. So I have a smartphone.
Okay. But, so you have a smartphone.
But it's a few years old.
But it doesn't have that capability. So I have, because it's 2019, I have an iPhone and it has that QI. Is that key QI? I don't even know if that one word or two.
It charges wirelessly.
That's exactly what it does. And so, you know, I, as the internet tends to do, I started down this rabbit hole of looking at wireless energy, wireless charging. And I guess I stumbled onto something that I was totally ignorant to, but you are very learned on. And I'd love to hear all about it because I did not know about this.
I wouldn't call myself very learned.
More than me.
I struggled to understand electronics most of the time. That's why I'm a mechanical engineer, not electrical.
Fair.
But that being said, I was super interested in wireless electricity kind of in junior high and high school, and super into all of Nikola Tesla's science.
Sure.
So essentially, wireless electricity works where you have a coil and you have another coil, and you just kind of pulse this coil, and then this looks weird. What am I doing with my hands? And then you pulse the other coil.
We have to make a graphic over this note to the editor.
Please censor my hands. They're making me uncomfortable. So you pulse two coils, and that creates alternating electromagnetic fields, and that allows you to move electrical power from one coil to another coil.
And that's like a root. That's like at the bare bones basics. Yes, that's what it looks like.
That's the explain like I'm five explanation.
Right. Okay.
Of wireless electricity. But there's different frequencies you can pulse them at. And at one point in time, Nikola Tesla imagined a future where all electricity is wireless.
Sure.
So you don't have power lines. What he wanted to do was use ultra high voltage, ultra high frequency to essentially create a certain layer of the atmosphere that vibrated. So instead of using a coil, he wanted to use the electromagnetic field of the Earth and an ionized layer of our atmosphere to be that starter coil. And then anywhere on Earth, you could just have a receiver coil and get electricity.
I love the idea, and I think in 2019, that's a fantastic idea.
It's also a little scary.
It's a little scary, but...
Think about it for electric cars, though.
For electric cars,
you just put a big coil on top of your car, run it to a motor, and you're fine.
Like, that would be awesome. And the company that I, you know, the rabbit hole that I stumbled down was this company called WattUp, and that's basically what they do is they have a product line of things that have these built-in transmitters that emit RF, and then you have a receiver on the other end that receives the RF and converts it to current and does just that. But it has some range issues, you know, like limitations in terms of how, because you don't use the ionosphere or whatever the hell Tesla wanted to do. But still really cool when you think about it. Like, okay, you know, you don't have 10 outlets on that wall, but your TV is a power station. And as long as you're within 10 feet of your TV, you're good. Or your table is a power station. Mm-hmm. As long as you're within 15 feet of your table, all of your anything with the receiver on that end is going to charge from that table. So the way that they have this set up is pretty neat. Maybe we'll have to link to it in the features. But yeah, seems like some pretty cool stuff. And I just didn't know about it. I thought it was cool technology. I don't know. Did you know about that? See, you guys are engineers too. You went to engineering school. Degreed gentlemen of learned science. And
But neither of us were electrical engineers, which I think is, you know, a key disclaimer here. You know, we were talking about...
Fair enough.
In school, we were talking about gears and mechanisms and four-bar linkages, and we were not talking about electronics beyond, like... This is a resistor. This is a capacitor.
I think a lot of people...
Don't stick a fork in the electrical outlet.
A lot of people have
sort of basics.
A job title of engineer, and anybody who's not an engineer just assumes you can do everything you've ever heard an engineer can do.
Right. Yeah.
Because I'm an electrician, which I'm not, but you know, because you're a mechanical engineer doesn't mean you know how to grade my driveway, or doesn't mean you can build my house or something like that.
I'm not the right guy to test soil composition to see if you can build a building.
Right.
That's not me.
Right.
But I had classmates and friends who did that all the time. I find that boring. They absolutely loved playing with dirt. So.
Well, there you go. Well, thank you guys for stopping by the video. We appreciate you watching. Be sure to subscribe. Check out our website. Watch for more videos, more podcasts, and let us know if you want to see us talk about something, do something cool with our 3D printers, do something with the technology. Do you want to see something printed on this studio desktop metal printer behind us? Let us know. Drop us a line. Bye.